The pandemic got us into a reflective space and made us look inward to see what we can do for the world at large. As a self-expression coach, I became a catalyst for women and started Vani, a one-on-one coaching program for women on finding their voice, to speak up, to be visible. As a storyteller, I spotted there were many ordinary people amongst us, leading extraordinary lives, making a difference to the world, and they needed to be heard. Thus was born You and I with Rashmi Shetty, where amazing personal journeys with their uniqueness and individuality are showcased. A reaffirmation of the fact, open your eyes wider, the world is far more beautiful when we acknowledge the presence of both you and I. Our guest today is Dr. Meenakshi Bharath, a gynecologist for 35 years and specialized in fertility work. Her medical practice consisted of making it easy for couples to undergo treatment to have children. Prevention is better than cure has always been her mantra. Her other passion stems from this mantra as she looks to prevent diseases created by garbage. From segregation to composting to using only reusables and having a waste-free wedding for her children, she is extremely active in converting people to sustainable ways of living. Having retired from active medical practice in 2018, she brings her passion for gynecology and waste management together in the campaign Green the Red, advocating reusable menstrual hygiene products like cloth pads and menstrual cups. Her aim is to make all women enjoy their periods and not hate it. Listen in as Dr. Meenakshi passionately describes her faith in the menstrual cup, which is completely healthy and eco-friendly. Hi, Dr. Meenakshi. Such a pleasure reconnecting. Your story and you have always been inspirational for me. And therefore, welcome to You and I with Rashmi Shetty.
Thank you very much, Rashmi. It's been quite some time since we met. Lots of water has flown under the bridge. I'm sure that things have moved on. And be it the pandemic or anything, I think we have learned lots of things in the last few years and are happy to share it with you.
Yes, and that is exactly what we're going to do through this conversation, because this was born in the pandemic as well. But before we get it there, the present, the current situation, I would love to know, what was Dr. Meenakshi as a little girl to the Dr. Meenakshi Bharath that the world knows today?
What I understand from what my relatives tell me is that I was quite determined child, and knew my mind right from the beginning. And on my sixth birthday, I decided I was going to be a doctor. So my father bought me, one of those toy doctor sets with a stethoscope, and that made my day. Why I wanted to become a doctor was because my father's younger sister was a doctor and I looked up to her. So that was the beginning of why I wanted to become a doctor. And somewhere in my third standard essay also, I did write that I want to become a doctor because I want to cure my father of his headaches and also go to the villages and help out the people who don't have medicine. But that never happened. It's happening in a different way now, but I'm sure that the service part of it was there right from the beginning. I did join St. John's Medical College in 1976 and spent 5 years there and enjoyed learning medicine, enjoyed making the friends that I did. And it was a left and right path-breaking moments for all of us. Later on in my life, I learned from my mother. My dad is a very conservative person and he was very worried that if I go into a co-ed school, I'll find somebody there and marry somebody there. So he took an assurance from my mother and my mother gave him the assurance saying that, don't worry, I brought up your daughter well. She will not go and marry somebody else. She will come back and marry the person that you propose. And coincidentally, it did happen. that when I finished my MBBS, immediately after finished my MBBS, I then came back home, and then down came Bharat, and the proposal happened, and within a week we were married. So many years afterwards, my mother said that, you know, I had my heart in my mouth till you actually decided to marry somebody that we approved of. I'm sure they would have approved of the other persons also. But, you know, we were still in that mindset that hamara community, hamara thing like that. I tell you, the risks that our parents take for us, enormous.
You were not aware of this promise that she had made to your dad.
No, no. We 6-7 years after I got married, she told me this.
Wow. Okay.
Never told me. That shows the sort of trust that she had in her child, the upbringing that she had brought up. But I think all parents will give their everything for their child.
True.
I remember on my 21st birthday, I said, Dad, I want to have a birthday party with all my friends. Can you send me 250 rupees? And 250 rupees in 1979 was a lot of money. And I didn't realize at that point what sort of things I was asking of my father, because my father must have been earning 1,500 rupees, and to give me 250 rupees must have been a lot of money. So he, without batting an eyelid, he sent me the money, and I had a great party with all my friends. And, you know, later years, when I sat down with him and said, what was your economics then? How much did you spend on me for my medical education? And it turned out that it was 25,000 rupees that he spent on me. And it was, you know, king's ransom at that point.
Sure.
And we don't even bat an eyelid when we ask our parents of some things and say, you know, can you really spare that sort of money? What are you depriving yourself of to give me what I'm asking you? These are things that just never occur to you. And then when I got married, I told Bharat, my father-in-law is not getting a handsome pension. He won't take money from you. So why don't you say that you will only pay him 500 rupees for his medicines, so that, you know, his ego is intact, your ego is intact, and you are helping them out monetarily. Being a son, you need to. So he says, oh my God, I had never thought about contributing to my father's income. I just took it for granted that he had enough. And at that time, in the late 70s and 80s, though they were all high government officials, their pension was very small. The OROP hadn't yet come in. And so their pensions were very small. And so they really had, you know, there was no butter. It was just the bread line that they had. So the 500 rupees that he gave sort of got them the butter. But it didn't strike him at all. So maybe I was already thinking that we need to help the previous generation. And that must be something that I got from my father, because my father used to always come home on leave and do some repair work for his father's house, do something for his siblings. He was the eldest of the family of 7 siblings. So he always did that. And I was the elder, and I had a younger sister who was 11 years younger. So it always came upon me that I must do something for her. Yeah, as I went into medicine and did. The other thing that my professor who was very fond of me, and I was, you know, just doted on him as a teacher, told me when I started working on garbage and cleaning and, you know, cleanliness, he says, Meenakshi, I knew, you know, you were doing this when you were 24-year-old. You're not doing this when you're 48-year-old. You were doing this even then. The labor rooms, you would tuck up your sari like that and then take off with the broom, and the poor ayahs would be so nonplussed that the doctor herself is cleaning the place. that they would come chasing after you and say, Nan mar kortini, you know. So it says you were fond of cleanliness way back then itself, not to the point of obsession, but you wanted things cleaner for everybody. So you always looked at doing something that would better the environment. So this was Dr. Rajshekhar from Davangere, who was, of course, our icon as a teacher. So, you know, it never struck me till he said it that, yes, I used to actually sit and clean the toilets, the labor room, all that without having any jijak. Lovely memories come back, you know, when you look at what all things you've done in the past.
True.
And how it reflects on the current and the future.
Yeah. In fact, what you spoke about parents, parenting, would definitely come to you only when you sit down and reflect on what a wonderful journey life has thrown at you. And while you're living it, sometimes we don't even realize what we are living till we pause to reflect. And it's conversations like these which lead us to my next question, which is 1976, when you joined the medical college, were there a good number of women in the medical college, or just few and far in between?
So we out of 60, we were 18 women. Okay. And of the 18 women, 9 were nuns and 9 were girls. Being a Christian college, they, of course, had a preference for Christians. Mm-hmm. But we were two girls, Uma and myself. We were the two non-Christians. But at that time, this religion didn't play any part in our lives. We were just colleagues. Mm. So religion didn't make any difference to us. We used to also go to church, go for Easter Sunday Mass, Christmas Mass. There was nothing. While they said, Hail Mary or whatever they were saying, we would say, Permale nine gatipa. So it's just a different language and a different person you're calling upon, because all of us used to do the same exam and all of us had to call upon some super strength to get through our exam tension and exams. So religion was not a big part or a dividing force at all for us. Mm. Religion was just what you were born into, what I was born into, no great shakes like that way.
Wow. And so from the India then to the India now, I'm sure you are seeing a lot of changes. But when you got into gynecology, was it something that was a natural choice, or was it something that you were again passionate about?
Well, when I took up, wanted to do post-graduation, I had three subjects in mind. One was pediatrics, one was psychiatry, and one was gynecology. I was already married and my husband was in the Middle East, so there were not many opportunities in the Middle East at that point. So pediatrics, while I was doing internship, those kids would scream at you and you could hear nothing. So by the end of the 1 month pediatric course that I did, I said, no more. Pediatrics is not my cup of tea. And so then I looked at psychiatry and then looked at gynecology. And by then I had a very good friend of mine called Dr. Philomena Vaz, who was mentoring me when I did my gynecology posting. And I liked the way she dealt with it. And I realized that when you do gynecology, you're looking at women who are, 90% healthy. Mm. So you're looking at a healthy population. You're not going to be tearing your hair apart, looking at disease. You are looking at prevention. You are making women healthy, and then you're giving them a happy child. And even then, in the 82, 83, I used to sit with the patient and counsel them and talk to them and explain exercises to them. Something that was, the bedside manners hadn't yet been told to us or taught to us. But I found myself doing it, and I found myself liking the fact that I could connect with the patient after the delivery and tell them, how do you sit and feed the baby? How do you deal with the various things? And the nice part at that time was we didn't have any disposables. So there was nothing to throw away, no garbage at all. The whole thing came up, you know, in 10 years time, by the time 1990 came up, all the disposables came into our lives. And that's when we started having so much of garbage. But I was, I came down to Bangalore for my first delivery in 88. And we were still using cloth nappies, you know, and I remember my mother spending 2-3 hours a day washing the cloth nappy with a soap that is not harmful to the baby and hanging it out in the sun. It's such a clear memory that she took that portion of her life so seriously that the baby must not get a nappy rash. And then, you know, and then I was so thrilled to see the pamper, the, you know, the diaper, the disposable diaper. I said, wow, what a wonderful invention. And I, you know, I'm aghast that I thought that it was a wonderful invention in 88. And now in 2008-10, I have been fighting to get people to use the reusable diapers for my grandchildren. All the three of them, we have only used reusable diapers. And saying, don't use throwables. Don't use anything that is single-use disposable. It's not good for our earth. And it was only in, I think, 2006 or something. Not 2006, 1996. We were going for a picnic in Dubai. And instead of taking the right turn, we took the left turn. And suddenly we found ourselves in the middle of huge mountains of garbage that was burning. And we said, oh my God, don't tell me this is where our garbage comes. And UAE has lots of land. So they were just dumping all the garbage there and setting it up on fire. So that was the first time that I actually encountered what happens to my garbage, that we are contaminating the soil around us, that we are creating rubbish. But even then, I remember we used to, when we went on picnic to the beach or so, we wouldn't have disposables. I would still have steel lotas and all that. So one of those days that we went for a picnic, my cousin brother did a clearance sale and 6 lovely steel lotas, he took it and put it into the dustbin. And then later on, I asked him, hey, Sanjay, where did my steel lotas go? Oh, I thought that they were disposable. Chucked it out like. So truly, you know, we were not the very disposable variety mindset. So when I came back, I came back with 36 melamine plates and so many glasses and IKEA. No, so IKEA has such wonderful reusables. Yeah. So brought that all back and I still have it. I've lost a few plates, but beyond that, most of it is still there. And so that was the beginning of the plate bank that, you know, happened in Bangalore, where people started sharing their plates. And their utensils for parties. Not everybody needs to have 100 plates. You have 20, you have 20, you have 20, and you just share it. Occasionally, you will lose one or two, or one will break, but it doesn't matter. So, you know, it was a building block that was happening about how to reduce the amount of garbage that you are producing. And I remember in the army days, my father is an army officer, the ladies, the wives would pride themselves on having napkins with lovely embroidery on it. And it was your showcase, how good a housewife you are to say, you know, crockery hai, cutlery hai, and then you have lovely napkins. So nothing disposable. So really we were brought up with the not disposable, non-disposable attitude. And I remember when we used to go travel in the train, we used to have hampers of khana.
Yeah.
Though we used to get khana from the railways also. And I remember such lovely dahi katori, steel katori, dahi aata tha, gut dahi. And it used to be a pleasure to travel because you used to get such nice food and nothing disposable. And nobody, you know, India was such an honest place. Nobody took away those katoris. We didn't flick the steel things that were there. Lovely place. I think India is a great country to be in. Even today, I have no qualms about coming back to India. 20 years we stayed in the Middle East. And then at the end of 20 years, just as my parents were growing older and the children were also growing older, we said, let's move to India so that the children can resettle themselves in India because they were 10 and 12. And I said, let's move back. Parents are not getting younger. They will need my assistance. And since, you know, my mission was to take care of my parents, even when I was a 6-year-old, so I said, let's move back. And we moved back in 2000. And I loved, I have loved every year of the 22 years we've been back in India. Done so many things that would not have been possible if we had continued to live in Dubai.
I know. No, I love the idea of the plate bank that you spoke about. And your son's wedding video has gone viral on how it was completely sustainable. So
I did that for my daughter's wedding also, except that because it was my daughter's wedding, I had no time to do any recording. But for my son, I therefore had the time. And Vani was standing right next to me and the photographer was standing there. So I said, come, Vani, let's do a video about it. And it just happened so spontaneously. And then...
No wonder it is so candid and real. Because it didn't look scripted and a lot of thought going into it. It was absolutely candid, but so very honest and from the heart. And I am really surprised. Now, are you realizing that everything that you had all the way while you were growing was completely sustainable, environment friendly, that now when you're connecting the dots, you can see the pattern? Or were you very aware as you were growing up about sustainability and being eco-friendly?
Not at all. The dots are now connecting. Like I told you, my professor, Dr. Rajshekar, said, that you were there, the same thing then. You are not any different person now. You haven't undergone a metamorphosis, except that this is coming to the fore. Mm. And like you so clearly said, the dots are now all connecting. And it's so heartening to know that the dots are connecting. And what is more heartening is to know that my children and their spouses are also of the same kind. So when my daughter got married, I went up to my sambandhis and said that I would like to have an eco-friendly wedding. Itara martara? It was the question. I said, neev nan mele bidi, neeve maadi anta. So I should actually send you the you know, they penned a song on me.
Oh.
It was so funny. So then, you know, nambigiti meenakshi, nodo kella sonakshi, something, it goes on. So they were very amused by the fact, but they just agreed to it and they really enjoyed everything that happened to them, you know, was dished out to them at the wedding. So they also agreed. And then my son's mother-in-law also went out of the way. That was the video that you saw, out of the way to, you know, make it completely eco-friendly. So, it's just that I think all like-minded people have come together. And Vani and I met in, Vani Murthy and I met in 2004. And we gelled so beautifully together that the first 10 years from 2004 to 14, we did so many projects together. It was very heartening and very nice. We learned together and we did together. It was completely very nice.
Okay, so here all eco warriors get together. Because was it at that time that Bangalore was getting really bad that you decided to pull your saris up and get into action? Or was it that, what is it that prompted you, that to get into the action mode?
No. So two things happened. One is my daughter got dengue in 2007. And at that point, she was in hospital for a whole week. And with all the resources of doctors, friends, and everybody, and the blood that we needed and all that, I went through a harrowing time because she was fairly serious. So I then began to think as to where did the dengue come from? And the dengue comes from garbage. Clean water in receptacles that are there in garbage. That's where the mosquitoes grow. So then after she got better, I started thinking as to how we can work that out. And suddenly in 2009, we found on the Independence Day, we found a whole lot of us eco-warriors in different places doing the same thing. And then we said, why don't we just join hands and have a better force? And that was when Solid Waste Management Roundtable Bengaluru was established. And suddenly we found that there were so many more people who wanted to do something. And when we told the politicians that, Bangalore is becoming a garbage city, we got fired by them. We got fired. How dare you call Bangalore garbage city? She said, but we are just seeing it before us. And we were a few years ahead of the times when we said that Bangalore is becoming garbage city. And we all got together, and it was just amazing how many people would come. So Vellore Srinivasan is one of the warriors in Almitra Patel. They came in and they taught us. And Vellore Srinivasan had an eco-friendly wedding for himself in 2004. So then that's when I learned how to do an eco-friendly wedding. And in 2011, the first eco-friendly wedding that I managed was my friend Ramya, her wedding. And it was so beautiful at the end of the wedding, not to have a truck full of garbage going out, to the landfill. We actually took all the yele and put it in my car and then took it to the Koramangala Goshala and watched the, cows eat it up like ice cream. That was when I realized that the bale yele is ice cream for the cows. And next morning it is cow dung. So we don't even have to worry about any garbage. So everything one on top of the other became knowledge and became executable and became environmental friendly and became cost effective also. Not only that, it was so cost effective. So then I can't understand why people don't want to do it. Just because of laziness? Are you wash your hand, wash your vessel, keep all the dishes in a bucket, keep it soaked so that it's easier to wash like we would do in our homes. We don't use disposables. So, just a change in mindset. And now there are people all over the country who are thinking about it. Yes, it may still be 1% or less than 1%, but the 1% are thinking about it. And the 1%, if they go into a position of, execution or an executive position, then they will be able to drive it that much faster. As citizens, we keep on banging, but somewhere it reaches.
And for all the work that you and Vani do in the space and the entire team does, how is the current generation to this whole thing? Very receptive, very easy to convince, or very responsible? What is the kind of reaction you're getting from there?
The younger generation are a little more eco-conscious, or they are conscious, but they don't know what to do. And when you explain that a paper cup is not really a paper cup, but there's a plastic lining in the middle, and that you are creating garbage, why don't you carry your own mug do it? So Vani has a very nice kit, that travel kit that we have. We used to go to Veena stores, if you know the famous Veena stores.
Yeah.
We used to carry our plate and glasses for coffee and idli and chutney there. But vena stores is still to get converted. He still uses disposables, but you know, people don't understand the economics of it. There's nothing to throw. There is a lovely dishwasher that you can have. So we used to carry our own thing and then bring it home and wash it and then take it the next time itself. So we have a travel kit. Anywhere we go, we carry our own bottle plus straw plus a vessel to eat. It just becomes a habit. When you're packing up things, you pack up such that you don't need any disposables at all.
And when did the menstrual cup come into your life? In the midst of all of this, or was there some other inspiration for it?
No, it was a progression. So when we started segregating our waste, we had wet waste, which we learned to compost. And the first time we learned to compost, we went to Vellore and learned about composting. And Vani and I were so excited. We brought back earthworms and we brought back cow dung. And Vani put her earthworms in a nice little bowl up on the terrace. And I put my earthworms, because they brought cow dung also, into another bowl with the cow dung in it. And come the next morning, Vani went up to her terrace to look at, hey, how are my earthworms doing? And all the earthworms were gone. The early bird had eaten up all the earthworms. And my poor earthworms, I had cooked them in the cow dung. They just died in the heat of the cow dung. I was, you know, seeing cow dung for the first time, though I had, you know, my grandmother had a goshala behind, but we never touched the cow dung. So I didn't realize that fresh cow dung is so heaty. So the poor earthworms died there. So that was our beginning of how we started looking at composting. So both of us experimented with our composting in different ways. Vani in a different way. Me, I wanted to do leaf waste composting, you know, that way. And from composting, then we looked at our dry waste, because segregation happened. And we looked at our dry waste and I said, oh my God, how much of garbage are we creating? So then we started using reusables and carry bags and all that stuff, cloth bags. And then we sort of slowly reduced the total amount of garbage. We even went to the extent of carrying our own bags and going and buying wholesale. It doesn't happen all the time, but we try to do it as much as possible. And then we were left with the reject waste. The reject waste was sanitary waste, by which time I had crossed my 50 and I was menopausal. So I had no sanitary waste coming from my house. My mother was menopausal and my daughter hadn't yet attained menarche. So I was looking at, what is the sanitary waste doing? And then we started looking at the evolution of the sanitary waste and what happens to it. And then suddenly somebody turned around and said, here is a menstrual cup, you know, this can be used. My friend, a French lady called Claire Rao, used the menstrual cup, and she had brought it from France. And we were so delighted with this menstrual cup. And then we said, wow, like, and as a gynecologist, it made complete sense to me. One, it was made of medical grade silicone. Two, it was so comfortable. It was intravaginal and it didn't hurt the vagina in any way. And it had three times the capacity of a normal pad. So it was a win-win for us. And I didn't have to worry about removing it every 4 hours because the capacity was three times that of a disposable sanitary napkin. And so we said, wow, this is the way forward for women to have healthy periods. Why do we need anything more than that? And that's innovation. And they said, no, people won't be willing to change. So we said, all right, let's look at all the things that we have changed to. So from the kerosene stove to the gas stove, we have changed. From the manual steering wheel to the automatic steering wheel, we have changed. From the manual gear to the automatic cars, we have changed. And now we are looking at getting into electric cars. From the mobile, landline phones, we have moved to mobile phones. Now, if we can do all these things, learning this so that you and I can have a happy period is just another small move. So then we said, okay, there is nobody who is giving awareness about this. Somebody has to give awareness about this. And then they all turned to me and said, Dr. Meenakshi, you're the right person. You're a gynecologist and you know, you're so passionate about it. I was passionate because I used it for one day and I said, God, I wish I were younger. I don't mind my gray hair, but I wish I was menstruating. But my poor uterus had called it a day. So what to do? So I said, all right, I missed the boat, but I don't want other younger women to miss the boat. You need to get the fear out of your head. And once you have the fear out of your head, once you begin using it, then it's life-changing. It completely transforms the way you look at menstruation. And then you say, why? It never troubled me. Why did I allow it to trouble me? Just because we were using disposable sanitary napkins. So cost-effective, 90% of the money you save, no trash, and the most comfortable feeling periods you have. So we used to wait to be pad free when we became menopausal. Now you are pad free the moment you start using the menstrual cup. So it's like that. So it's been a wonderful journey. And since 2015, we've been going hammer and tongs about this also, along with being eco-friendly in other ways. This is healthy. This is comfortable. This is non-irritant to the vagina. This is no rash on your thighs. No worries about peeing and pooing, and no worries about needing lots of water to wash it. You need half a cup of water to wash it. And so it's a win-win situation completely. And many a people will turn around and say, I'm so scared of using it.
Yes.
I said, you're not scared of having intercourse. Why should you be scared about using this? This is just the same thing. So open your mind to it. If you open your mind to it, then this is the most comfortable thing. And then should I sterilize it? Should I wash it with hot water and all that? So I was one day sitting and thinking, what do we do when we have intercourse? We don't wash our husbands with hot water before having intercourse. Then why do we need to do this? The vagina is an unsterile organ. So let the vagina take care of itself. You don't have to be overprotective of your vagina. The vagina knows what it needs to do, and you have to just wash it with plain, cold, half a mug or half a cup, not even a mug, half a cup of normal water that is flowing in your tap. That's all. You don't need to do anything else. We actually don't think about, are we on a sterile surface? Do we have a clean bed sheet? Are we clean before we have intercourse? Oh God, we just close our eyes and have intercourse, right? So then why are we so hyper about what we put inside our vagina? God gave a vagina that is completely capable of taking care of itself. So it's the menstrual cup is a win-win situation for women who want to have comfortable periods. And I think all of us want to have comfortable periods.
True.
Just that we are not aware of how to have it. And the advertisement, if you actually look at it now, they are advertising the disposable sanitary pads with extra vigor. Suddenly, they have competition that was not there before. The cup has become competition for their 17,000 crore industry in India, and they don't want to lose out. The same way that the kerosene stove people just stopped producing kerosene stove and moved on to produce something new, these people must stop holding on to their kursi, which is their pad, and say, let us do something good. It gets us money. So, okay, you can use a cup for 10 years. Don't we use a laptop for 10 years? Don't we use a TV for 10 years? Don't we use a fridge for 10 years? But you have a market for that. There are so many Girias and so many Chromas that sell us these things. So move on. Don't hang on to your 19th century product. Go to the 21st century product. This is the 21st century product. Should we not move on like we have moved on with our mobile phones, like you have now taken up to podcasting to what it was before, what you were doing AIR radio broadcasting. It's become a podcast now, and it is so very popular. So we have to move with the times, and menstrual cup is moving with the times.
Very beautifully said, Dr. Meenakshi. And when it comes to usage of menstrual cup, what is one of the most astounding questions that you have ever heard in this journey while you were talking about it? And what was one of the most deep questions that came to you as you were talking about it?
I still think that what astounds me is that women are scared of using the menstrual cup. When you deliver your baby, you're delivering a coconut-sized head. When you're having intercourse, it's the same size of the menstrual cup that goes inside. And what astounds me is medical people also have the same fear that the common man, common woman has. It doesn't make sense to me. Because you are, as a gynecologist, we are examining a woman in her vagina every day, day in and day out. Then why is it that we are ourselves scared? So that's something that I haven't been able to fathom out. But there is a learning curve. And once you go over the learning curve, then you shoot off. So there are many stages of cupwarting. I call it cupwarting. So the first stage is, no, main cup nahi pehen sakti ho. Impossible. Then your friend comes and says, are main use karti ho, itna aaram hai, tum bhi use karo. So then you say, all right, thoda sa ghabrahat, I'll remove it from my head and I will put it, let me try it. Then the first time I try it, अंदर फंस गया मैं क्या करूं, डॉक्टर के पास जाना है. देन यू मैनेज टू रिमूव इट एंड देन यू से, अरे अंदर डालने में मुसीबत नहीं थी, बाहर निकालने में मुसीबत नहीं थी. सो द नेक्स्ट मॉर्निंग यू कैच अप विद योर फ्रेंड एंड से, इट वाज सच अ वंडरफुल एक्सपीरियंस. एंड देन द थर्ड फ्रेंड यू विल से, आप नहीं इस्तेमाल करते हो, अरे यू मस्ट यूज इट. सो देन यू आर इन द कप वर्टिंग सिचुएशन. And then you are, of course, tom-tomming to everybody. So the 4 or 5 stages of cup version is too funny when you look at it. So you go
like
from
an animated film that I just saw.
it is so it's truly like that. So just before the pandemic started in March of 2021, February, I had an opportunity to go to Vani Vilas Hospital and speak to the doctors and nurses there about the menstrual cup. And 10 of them, 5 doctors and 5 nurses took it up. And then suddenly the pandemic struck and you were then posted to the COVID ward where 8-hour duty, you were wearing those COVID dresses and you couldn't remove it, you couldn't go to the bathroom, you couldn't. And periods, of course, never listen to any calamity. Periods will come, especially when you have a calamity, that's when it'll come on the dot, 30 days. So they would all get their periods. And those who were using the menstrual cup actually never had any problems. They were so comfortable because the menstrual cup has the capacity of 3 pads and they didn't need to change anything in those 8 hours. They were ever so grateful that they got to know about it and that they took it up just at the right time. So for doctors, for air hostesses, for people who have long duty hours, for teachers who don't have time to go to the bathroom when they are having their classes, their duty, just any woman who goes to the farm and has to work for her 8 hours or the tea plantation, she doesn't have any bathroom. This is the thing to use. So truly something that is earth-shattering and transforming for women is the menstrual cup. So my entry to everybody who is there is use the menstrual cup, experience it. Jaise Amitabh Bachchan bolte hai na, pehle istamal karo, phir vishwas karo.
Wow, deep at the same time, the Meenakshiism intact. At this point, Dr. Meenakshi, normally where we move is the pandemic, because you and I stands for uniqueness and individuality. The whole purpose of the podcast is to draw out how each one of us is unique in our own contribution to whatever we are doing, and individual, still we all meet somewhere, because the common good is what most of us hold together. And if each one goes out and sees, when we move beyond ourselves to make a difference to the world at large, there's a very beautiful space we are all occupying. The pandemic has been reflective for all of us. What has it done to you?
One is, of course, it's like most people said, we as a family got together. We spent time together. And we even did exercise on the terrace together, because we didn't want to go out. So it was the first lockdown was very good, because we actually lost weight. That was one. Two, we realized that we could actually subsist with not shopping. So I think 2 years or so, we did no shopping. Jo ghar mein tha, usi ko istamal kiya. And then you totally forgot about being a show off to others. You know, you get dressed up to show how beautiful you are to others. You actually went inwards and realized that there is so much beauty in you and in the people around you, that you don't need to be wearing lipstick and whatever else, makeup and fancy clothes and all that. Not necessary. We can live with whatever we have most comfortably. Just roti, kapda aur makan. And a lot of us are fortunate to have that bit of roti, kapda aur makan. And then you started looking at what happens to those who lost their, you know, earnings, lost their jobs. Then you started doing something for it. And at that point, I told people, don't distribute disposable sanitary napkins. They only last you one period. I mean, they only last you 6 hours. They don't even last you a day. So don't dispose. Give them cloth pads. Give them menstrual cup. They will learn, you know, in an emergency, you learn so many things. In an emergency, you learn to swim, because you don't want to drown. Yeah. So they will learn that and they will use it. And so that was the time that we actually revved up the production of cloth pads for young girls and menstrual cup, and did so many. And the Zoom platform just opened the windows to everybody. We were going to one school and speaking to 100 children. We were now speaking to somebody in Africa and somebody in America and somebody in Australia. It didn't matter. The world had become totally shrunk because of the virtual platform. And that was a revelation to all of us, that we could now be friends with so many people. We haven't met over 2 years, but just because we've been on the Zoom platform, we have become such wonderful friends and that done so many projects together. So it is like that, you know. I think that has been a great learning for us. And of course, we have all had to rev up our abilities to learn new things. So if you can learn how to do Zoom, I'm saying you can all learn to use the menstrual cup. And I'm passionate about it, because I want women to have happy periods, periods without any abdominal cramps, the dysmenorrhea that we talk about, and no rash and no trash. This is 15 grams of medical grade silicone that will take you for 10 years. Just imagine, instead of 1,800 pads that you will throw, this one cup will carry you for 10 years. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
I keep saying, you know, your Mangal Sutra is for showing others. The cup is for using it for yourself. People say, oh my God, this is Meenakshiism. No. Don't tell me about what she said. My comparisons can be a little embarrassing, but that's when you remember that, you know, that is how, that is the difference that a menstrual cup can make.
True. And your passion is definitely visible. And three Meenakshiisms, life lessons that you'd like to leave us with, Dr. Meenakshi, which you have taken from life and would want to share with us.
When you leave your house, plan what you're going to do. And carry a few things, carry a cup, carry a plate, definitely carry the menstrual cup, whichever holiday you're going for, so that you don't have to go and buy, you know, disposable pads. Don't use tissues, use napkins. They make a big difference. Wash your hand. You don't have to put sanitizers. I'm not for sanitizers because we need the bacteria around us to keep us healthy. So there's this huge issue about the microbiome that is there in our body. And if we get rid of the microbiome, we are inviting the pathogenic bacteria to come in and live inside us, which is no good. So wash your hand. No need. 99% of the bacteria will be washed away with this soap. What do you mean by that? You need the 99% bacteria. You don't need the 1% bacteria. So that is something that I find very distressing. The world at large is looking at how much money they can make. The world at large is not looking at how can you make this world a better place to live in. Yes, you will still make some money. But do you need it in crores? You don't need it in crores. Roti, kapda aur makan utna hi chahiye. And yeah, as you grow older, the roti becomes less and less. The fruit and the vegetables becomes more. And ek hi bistar pe so sakte hain. So, 10 makan bana ke kya fayda? Though, of course, I have more than one makan. People will turn around and say, of course you have Meenakshi. But we did that at a time where we didn't realize that we should have bought land and grown things on it. I, for one, if you have a piece of land, I will give you an avocado sapling, which is 3 feet tall, and you can get lovely avocados. So I keep growing as many fruit trees as I can. Remember, we did that huge protest about save the trees on Sankey Tank. And that was when I decided to grow my own plants in my house and trees in my house. And then every fruit that I ate, I tried to propagate it so that it could go somewhere and grow and become a tree. So each of them evolved into something new. So think about not creating any garbage. So I tell people, don't eat chips, eat banana. You know, healthier, faster energy for you. And you can compost it and it will create lovely food for the plants. So I think that's basically what we need to do. Think beyond us. There is more to us than just me and my intestinal parasites. Take care of everybody around you and the pleasure. And most importantly, I have the pleasure of having my parents with me. And though we are alike and we rub against each other and have altercations, it's such a pleasure to be 63-year-old and have your parents with you and take care of them the same way that we took care of, they took care of us and our children. Not only us, our children also, they brought them up to be such wholesome human beings. I owe them a lot, both my parents and my parents-in-law I owe them a lot. And I've had the good fortune of now in the last 10 years doing things for my parents, which I didn't do because they were young and fit before. They're not young and fit anymore. Remember that they must have sacrificed so much. And when I look at it, what are the things that they did for me and sacrificed for themselves? I realize, oh my God, the least I can do is to, take care of them as they become more frail and, frail in the body, frail in the mind. I don't know where I'm going to go. And my daughter says, Mom, you're not going to be like this. You better be, nicer to us. So yes, so it comes by example. If you will take care, my father took care of his parents. Therefore, that was the example that I had. I took care of my parents. Then there is a good chance that my children will take care of me in my, old age, cranky self, whatever. But that is something that we all need to remember, that we should take care of the older fogies because they're not capable of doing what they are. And at 40, you don't even think. When I was 20 and my father said that he was friends with his friend for the last 40 years, I said, oh my God, what an old man he must be. Because from first standard to 40 years, they were friends, or 45 years, they were friends. And now I have friends who are been friends for the last, from 18 to now 63, that's 45 years. And as we grow older, we realize that the knees are creaking and you can't climb up the stairs as fast enough. And then we realize that, yes, old age is coming up. However fit you think you are in the mind, it is coming up. So enjoy every bit of your life. You don't know when your cup will be full and you will just conk it like that. But if we conk it like that, we are very fortunate without suffering. The other day, my colleague's brother-in-law just sat on the chair and died. By the time his wife came from the bathroom, he was no more. What a wonderful way to go. Yes, shocking to the relatives, but for him, it was the most wonderful way to go. So we just pray that, God will give us a nice ending. But in the meantime, enjoy every bit of it and don't harm. I mean, though it sounds preachy, don't be nasty to anybody. Always think that if that statement was made to me, how would I feel? And if you thought that you would feel cringy, then don't make that statement because you're going to make that other person feel miserable. So joy is what you must give everybody. And I think I try to do that to the best of my ability. Of course, I will, chuko sometime, but that's the idea.
Wow, you definitely are a woman who lives every minute, every second of your life. Thank you so much for this rich life lesson, the book that you gave us. I asked you for three, you gave us a book. You really are generous. And people who do not think just of themselves, but go beyond, and more than anything else, the planet Earth that we need to now give to our children, because we've only borrowed it from them. And what a beautiful lesson. You're doing it every day with the life that you're leading, Dr. Meenakshi. May your tribe increase. May God bless you with all that you need. And honored to have you on You and I with Rashmi Shetty. A pleasure completely mine. And may all your dreams come true.
Thank you so much, Rashmi. Thank you. It was a pleasure talking to you.
With that, we come to the end of this weekly quest of You and I with Rashmi Shetty. Do let us know if you know people who make the world beautiful. Write in to rashmi.thethirdeye@gmail.com. That is rashmi.thethirdeye@gmail.com. Come, Let's explore this amazing world together, both you and I.